Hi, everybody. It's Sandra Brown with the Institute for Relational Harm Reduction and Public Pathology Education, coming to you from the Institute's retreat house, where I am sheltering in place, at least in a really beautiful location, with three grandkids and a daughter. So I wanted to take a few minutes during this challenging time to talk about how to prevent triggering, guarding your mental health, and six ways to do it during this time period. So I already wrote an article about it. And I'm going to go over these points from this. I actually wrote this article for the World Narcissistic Abuse Awareness organization for them to utilize for their survivor base. And so I'm going to use it for my own survivor base too. So before we get to that, I do want to say, I did an interview since, the virus, and somebody was asking me about my concern for my client base for trauma survivors, and was I hustling and bustling to get things in place for you. And so while I am concerned because trauma survivors, still have the ability to get triggered by things that push their buttons. And we'll talk about what that is in a minute. But what I said to them was that you guys, have a skill set, depending on how far you are in recovery, that a lot of people out there don't have, and that my money is on you because you have been through hard things, because you do know what it feels like to experience what feels like powerlessness. You do know what isolation is like. I mean, anybody that has been through a pathological relationship, knows these things and has experienced these things. And so depending on how far along you are in your recovery, has a lot to do with, what skills that helped you get through then that is helping you get through now. And so you can call on those skills, and we're going to talk about, some of the ways to do that. So probably the number one reason why survivors would get triggered is that trauma is produced under two circumstances, and that is fear and powerlessness. And that's what likely created your original wounding or your original trauma, whether it's all the way back in childhood or whether it was created in the pathological relationship or revisited in the pathological relationship from early childhood, however it got there. Trauma is created in those conditions of fear and powerlessness. And so this virus, is pushing a lot of people's buttons with fear and powerlessness, just in everybody, not just trauma survivors. And so this is very similar, to what we saw in 9/11, in which the whole country ended up having what we call vicarious trauma. And that is trauma that you don't have to experience firsthand. You know, it's not like regular trauma where it happens directly to you. You experience the sexual assault. You experience the domestic violence. In vicarious trauma, it happens from exposure to other people's fear or powerlessness or what has happened to them. And so we can have mass vicarious trauma where the entire country becomes traumatized. And we saw that happen through 9/11. And I happened to be working a little bit at a hospital at that time. And they called me over to the main campus, you know, as a trauma therapist to deal with that. And when I went in, it wasn't patients that they called me to work with. It was the personnel. It was the doctors and the nurses, et cetera. And in the break room, they had the television on. And of course, the media just played that same scene over and over again of the towers. And people just sat there, and not just doctors and nurses, but the whole country sat there for days and probably saw that image 50 to 100 times, in which they developed trauma at their own hands. So no, they're not responsible for, you know, 9/11, but they are responsible for their level of exposure to something that does cause trauma. And so we learned a lot about vicarious trauma through 9/11, that it is that people that don't have post-traumatic stress will develop post-traumatic stress or vicarious trauma symptoms from overexposure. And the same thing is true now with the virus. And you know that there's this thing called anxiety contagion, and that means anxiety is contagious. And so as you are, you know, watching TV and the news media over and over again, and they show clips of, you know, panic in other people, that's going to raise panic, you know, in you. And especially if you are empathic by nature, that's going to kick that up. If you have trauma, that's going to kick that up. If you have anxiety, an anxiety disorder, which trauma is an anxiety disorder, that's going to kick that up. So I'm here to say that you are responsible for your own mental health. So I can tell out there that people already have vicarious trauma. And the way I can tell that is that they can't step away. So you know how trauma keeps drawing you to that thing over and over again? You've probably had that experience, that after the pathological relationship, you were drawn to articles or books exactly about that. And you read everything. Well, people, when get vicarious trauma, they stay glued to the TV. And when you try to intervene and say, that's probably not good for your mental health, you need to continue as much as you can with your regular life, go take a walk, clean out a closet, do a hobby, you know, do something like that, their comeback is, I actually had someone who said to me, get your head out of your ass. We have to stay informed. something could happen, you know, at any minute, and we have to know everything. And you can hear the anxiety and that they are already traumatized by their choice to overexpose themselves to ongoing media. And of course, the media is going to do that. I mean, that's what, unfortunately, we live in a culture where the media is based on fear and powerlessness, or people would never tune in. So we usually, you know, don't tune in to hear somebody gave somebody a puppy, you know, some wonderful thing, where the media has trained us, you know, in fear and powerlessness. And so the media is just going to do what the media is going to do. And, you know, they keep all of this kicked up. And it's unfortunate, you know, because people do get vicarious trauma from them. The same thing is online, because whoever is on your friends list is posting stuff from the media. One bad thing after the other, the next case of the virus, the next case. Everybody needs to stay informed, there are ways of doing that without traumatizing yourself, and we're going to talk about that. But I want to first encourage you, and just like I said in this interview, is that trauma survivors often have better skill management for dealing with things if they can remember to go back to what helped them in the early days after the relationship. The kinds of things that helped you get through that tough time. That's the exact stuff you should be pulling up. And that's why I said, my money is on you, because you have skills that other people who have had, you know, a fairly untraumatized life don't have, because they never had to develop those skills. And the thing is, you might find people turning to you. You might be actually calmer than some of the other people who have never had to learn how to deal with anxiety or how to develop coping skills. And I have a lot of our clients who are saying, you know, people are turning to me, which is sort of funny because I'm the one with anxiety disorder, but they see that I know some things about anxiety and what to do. And so you might find people turning to you. And we're going to talk about that too, because that, you know, you got to take care of yourself first, that, you know, that oxygen mask on you first before you begin taking care of an overwhelmed population. You first, so that you can be functional, you know, for your kids and your family. So let's talk about a couple of things. Number one is that you do need to be informed but not overwhelmed. Because yes, you have a trauma disorder and that can rattle that. So use trusted sources of information when you do go to get updated, like the CDC website, not Fox News, not CNN, not social media. Just go get, from the main source, which is the CDC, and get your update and get off and go on about your day. And just know that, you know, early in recovery, you had to find accurate sources of information to understand what was happening. And the process is the same here. Find reputable information to decrease your fear and increase preparedness. So that's number one, get informed but not overwhelmed. Number two is check your trauma thinking. Traumatic thinking in yourself or the vicarious traumatic thinking from others is all about fear of the future, which can set off feelings of powerlessness. So keep checking in on your thinking, because your thinking, if it gets out of control, dysregulates your emotions. So you need to stay away from the feelings, you know, of vulnerability. And know that you are as prepared as you can be, and to go back to those skill sets that you, you know, learned early on in recovery. And so reframe negative thoughts to help reduce the adrenaline, which is a fight or flight reaction. So we got to pay attention to our thinking, and we need to reframe thoughts before it kicks off the adrenaline and fight and flight. For instance, instead of thinking I am isolated, reframe it as I get to be safe at home and spend time with my family. Instead of the community is acting crazy and the resources will run out, reframe as I have prepared for this and have what I need for now, and important places like stores and medical care is still open. Reframe. If others you are staying in contact with are showing signs of vicarious trauma, such as fear of the future or focusing on the fear message from the media, limit your time talking with them, just as you should be limiting your own time with media and social media. You know, whatever we focus on grows. So if we focus on fear and we focus on anxiety, those symptoms increase. And so if you've got your friend who's awfulizing and calling you, you know, five times a day, you need to put the oxygen mask on you first to take care of your mental health and your children's mental health. And so I want to remind you that early in recovery, you recognize the benefit of going no contact to reduce traumatizing yourself and to reduce the toxicity. And it might be necessary to go no contact with those friends, family, whoever, neighbors, who can't regulate their own worldview of this situation and who are stuck in talking about it over and over again. Your first priority is to stay mentally balanced for yourself and your family. So number two is to keep checking your trauma thinking and getting rid of stuff that is increasing trauma thinking. Number three, jack up the self-care. So this is the time for your self-care regimen. Everything you have learned about how to self-care for yourself in the early days and mid time of recovery will give you the knowledge to utilize now. For those of you that are in our living recovery program, our online trauma reduction program, go back into the lessons. There's tips, techniques, all that stuff is in your material. You might have done it a few months ago, but you can go back. The material is always available to you. So go back into the lessons and pull up some of that tips, techniques, and self-care, anxiety reduction kinds of stuff. Also during the self-care, utilize soothing skills to reduce symptoms. Utilize things like breathing, which, you know, in the Living Recovery Program, we taught breathing as a core technique for managing, you know, anxiety. So go, you know, go back to that. We taught grounding techniques. Pull that material up. You need to be using this maybe, you know, every day or sometimes, you know, maybe multiple times a day, and teach it to your children if they're having anxiety. Use peaceful imagery, calming sounds, laughter, music, art, relaxation activities. So number three is to make sure you jack up your self-care. You were taught all of that for such a time as this. And so now is the time to blow the dust off of it and resurrect it. Number four, focus on what you can control. So like I said, you know, trauma is created and based on the issue of fear and powerlessness. And powerlessness, you know, is that feels like we don't have any control over something. So just like after the D&D, the discard, the devaluing and discard, and everything felt out of your personal control, and you had to focus on the things you did have some control over, now is the time to focus on the things, again, you do have control over, to reduce the sense of powerlessness. For instance, what you prepare for a meal, what activities you're going to do that day, how much and how often you self-care, what you're going to do to get outside and get a little air and exercise, maybe what online class or workshop you could take during this time. You need to reframe, just like we were talking about before, what it is that you're focusing on. And even say it out loud or make a list of the things that are in your control and focus on those things. So that was focus on what you can control. Number five, meaningful distraction. So after the devaluation and discard, you found ways of distracting yourself so you could redirect your thinking away from the confusion and loss. And so, no, you didn't do it right away. But eventually, that's what helped you begin to control your mind, is that you began to redirect your thinking. And so now is the time to inject meaningful distraction. And there's nothing wrong with that. We're all doing that. We're all finding ways of distracting ourselves or our kids. It could be like all the projects you have wanted to do if you just had time. Spring cleaning, that online course you wanted to take to work more on your recovery and symptom reduction skills. This is a great time to go back and go through your living recovery program again, even if you already graduated. Lots of our survivors go through more than once because they're more grounded the second time they go through and they get more out of it. Go back through your living recovery program. To finally get back to interests you had before the D&D, like writing or art, gardening or cooking. So many people have said that that's what they used to do before the pathological relationship, in which they haven't, you know, gotten back to that, which really helps them, you know, feel more like themselves when they enter back into the things that were important in their life before the relationship. So some of my clients are telling me they're using this time to catch up on sleep deprivation that happened because of anxiety or the relationship, that kind of stuff. And to spend more quality time with your kids, to get more exercise, to learn yoga in your living room, those kinds of things. So again, with this issue about reframing our thinking, view this time as a gift to reconnect to the meaningful life you used to have before the pathological relationship. So find number five is meaningful distraction. And number six is stay connected. And so, you know, recovery is all about community. And I've always said that on our Institute Facebook page, which is the Institute for Relational Harm Reduction, is I talk a lot about the concept of ourself, the Institute, as in a recovery community. We are not just a social media page. We are a recovery-based community, and we heal in community. We heal in relationship and in relation to others. So stay connected to others, you know, during this time, those friends and family who are not exhibiting vicarious trauma and fear the future that could be triggering. So other people that are more balanced and aren't off the rails right now, stay connected. Have a phone buddy that you check in with daily. Reach out to those people you have meant to stay in contact with. It's a great time to catch up on old relationships. And, you know, some of our clients are telling us that they are using this time very recovery oriented, and that they are recognizing as they advance in their recovery that a lot of relationships were damaged because of their relationship with the pathological partner. All those relationships that fell away, or all those relationships he or she isolated you from those people. And just like in the 12-step program, there is a step in the step work about making amends to the people that were harmed because of your issue in with the pathological person. And so our survivors are telling us that they're doing that step work during this time to reach out and try to make amends during this time period where they have time to invest again in that relationship by, you know, talking things through on Skype or on the phone or through email, and that they're using this time to mend some of the relationships that were harmed. And I think that's a great use of this issue about staying connected. And, you know, if need be, find trauma-informed care support online that is positive and forward-facing. You know, I'm a Nazi about this. Don't go sit in narcissistic abuse survivor groups that are awfulizing about this and everything else about the relationship. That's not going to help you. That is not trauma-informed care. That is not positive, and that is not forward-facing. That's not what you need right now. Find trauma-informed care sources for that. So utilizing what you already know is right there inside of you. Just recycle it for this important hurdle and apply those six suggestions that I made. And I'm going to try to check in, you know, during this time period. So keep checking back on our Facebook page with the Institute for Relational Harm Reduction page. That's where I will be posting it. If you're in our Living Recovery Facebook group, go to the Institute because we have a wider readership there, and I'm just going to be posting it there. But I will be coming back in, you know, to touch base with you. So I'm feeling, you know, okay. I'm feeling fine, actually, you know, to be able to continue to be a support to you. And the reason is, is that, you know, half of the year I am at the retreat house here, which is on a mountain in the middle of nowhere. And the little town that is here is pretty far away. So 6 months or more of the year that I am here, I am very isolated. Sometimes, you know, I'm here by myself if there's not a retreat or another program we're running. Right now, you know, I have grandkids here with me. But this issue about being isolated is not an issue for me, because that's how I live. The other half of the year, when I'm at my house at the lake, it is a little town in the middle of nowhere. So in both locations, I'm used to being isolated. I'm used to not going out for weeks at a time, you know, because I work from remote locations or wherever I'm at, you know, unless I'm having clients in or doing retreats or whatever. That's just how my life is. So this hasn't rattled me. So that's good, because I feel very fine and very focused to be able to be a support to you during this time. So keep checking back. Use these six ways to prevent triggering and guarding your mental health, and I'll be checking back with you. So this has been Sandra Brown with the Institute. Be well, stay safe.